Good morning. I so enjoy Teen Challenge coming. What a blessing they are to see transformation in real time. You see it. And every time they come, I say, you got to do the video. You got to show those before and after photos, because that's God at work. Huh? Doing a work in the... I'm talking about transformation. Lives being changed. And that's what they're doing. So when you give, you're giving to the kingdom. You're not just giving to sticks and stones and in equipment. You're actually giving to change lives. So every time you give, a life is being changed because of your gift. Hallelujah. You're investing in the kingdom. And to Alan, thank you and your team and Sarah and all that you guys do. What a blessing you are. And I'm going to share these testimonies with people that I know. Those of you watching online, we've got a video we're going to show you at the end of the service as well. And so I'm just excited to be here. Today is July 4th. Amen. Oh, my goodness. And you came to church on July 4th. Like, whoa. It's so good to have you here. I'm going to pick up in part 17 of our sermon series in the book of John. And then after I'm done, we're going to have communion. And then we've got some great barbecue tri-tip and chicken. And this is not a meal that you have to pay for. And it ain't $10 a plate. It's free. Amen. And so you go there and eat as much as you want, long as you want, just eat and enjoy. Don't go just yet, though. Hold on. And so I'm going to, just have a word of prayer with you and then get into this sermon. So, Father, thank you for this huge moment in time that you have given to us to look into your word, to be blessed, to see with our eyes what you have done in changing the lives of men and women. We pray, God, that you would take this word, which is already anointed, that you place it in our heart. God, that we would hide it there as well. And God, that we would allow your word to shape and to mold us, that we might become more and more like your son, the Lord Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. So grab your Bibles, everyone, and go with me to John chapter 17. And again, after we're done here, we're going to have communion. So I'm sure the greeters will make sure that everyone has their cup if you don't have it already. So John chapter 17. Let me turn there myself. John chapter 17. All right, if you have it, just say amen. So I did a short introduction to it this past Tuesday. I'm just going to briefly review that, then jump into some other verses in John chapter 17. This is only, I can't expound on every verse, but you, when you go home, you need to dive into this. And you need to be like the Bereans, who after Paul preached to them, they went home to search the scriptures to make sure that what Paul said was accurate. Amen? Just because the man or woman is up here delivering the word of God, just don't sit there idle. You need to go home and verify, is this accurate, what they're saying? Does this line up with the word of God? Amen? And so I'm going to challenge you to go home today, this week, begin to look at the word of God, and God begin to guide you into all truth. It says here in John chapter 17, and remember, John is writing this. He was there in the upper room. This takes place in the upper room, and he's watching Jesus, and he's watching Jesus and his actions. And Jesus begins this prayer, and it says how Jesus, in verse 1, lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, that kind of goes against the way we've normally been taught to pray. Typically, we will close your eyes and bow your heads, but here we see Jesus lifting his head up and opening his eyes and praying unto the Father. Now, understand this. This is perhaps, and I would say, the most important prayer that we can find in Scripture. Now, some of you may want to debate with me, and that's all right. Go ahead and debate with me, but I think that I'm right. I know that we have a prayer in the book of Genesis where Abraham is interceding on behalf of Sodom, so Sodom would not be destroyed, right? We have a prayer of Moses, I think in Exodus chapter 32, I think, where the Israelites had made this golden calf. Aaron said, they just gave me the gold. I threw it in the fire, and this thing just came out of the fire, this golden calf. I don't know what happened. And so God's getting ready to just wipe out Israel, and Moses intercedes for him. We also see Solomon intercede or praying for the dedication of the temple. And those are great prayers, but I think this is the most important prayer. I know that we have said in the past, we've looked at Matthew chapter 6, and we have defined that as the Lord's Prayer. Everyone say the Lord's Prayer. Right, but I would argue with you today, and I would say I think John 17 could be more accurately listed as the Lord's Prayer, for it is the Lord praying. Amen? You know, in Matthew chapter 6, he says you ought to pray like this, but here in John chapter 17, we see the Lord praying. And what an amazing thing to be an observer in that upper room and watch the Lord pray. One of the great things about going to prayer meetings is you learn how to pray. You may say, well, I don't know how to pray, because you don't go to a prayer meeting. That's your problem. If you were in prayer meetings, you would learn how to pray. Because you'd be able to observe men and women who have been in this for a while, how they pray. And you could say, okay, I'm going to take this, I'm going to take this, I'm going to add to how I pray. That's how I learned how to pray, by watching prayer warriors pray. How do you become better at basketball? I go and practice and watch others play. Amen? You can't sit at home and not attend a prayer meeting and then say, I don't know how to pray. Of course you don't. Because you don't go and pray. I'll get off of that. And so this again, I believe this is the most important prayer that has been recorded in the Word of God. And so in the beginning, he prays for himself that the Father would glorify him, that the Son could glorify the Father. Father, the hour has come. Now, prior to this, you know, Jesus had said on many occasions, my hour is not yet. They ran out of wine. Mom says, hey, son. Jesus says, woman, my hour is not time yet. Right? They tried to grab him and to arrest him at certain times and stone him and throw him off a cliff, but he got away because his hour had not come yet. But now here he says, my time is now come. I'm ready to be offered up. Now his mind, his focus is on something we would not have focused on. His focus was on the cross. I'm going to the cross. And I'm going to pay the price for everyone's sin. I'm focused on that. So it says, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you. Jesus understood the way to glorify the Father was going to be through the cross, to finish the plan that the Father had set even before time had begun. Angels did not understand the plan. Prophets who had prophesied in part did not understand the plan. Only the Godhead knew the plan. Even the devil himself did not understand the plan. For if he had understood the plan, he would not have participated in it, but he did not. He thought he was destroying the Son of God. Oh, yeah, we got him now. Little did he know, Jesus came out of that grave. I got all power. Huh? I got all power. Huh? I'm setting every captive free. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. And so he prays for himself in verses 1 through 5. And then he turns in verse 6. We're going to pick it up here. He begins to pray for his disciples then. Now, understand this. At this very moment in time, Judas has left the scene. He has gone to do what he thinks he needs to do. And so it says here in verse 6, I have manifested to make known beyond teaching, I've to manifest, to declare, to show in real time. It says, I have manifested your name to the men whom you have given me out of the world. He declared the very character and the words of the Father. He displayed that to those disciples. Yes, he did. And he said, the ones you have given to me. If you compare this phrase here with Luke chapter 6, you will notice that Jesus spent all night in prayer before those disciples were chosen. And so during the time of prayer, the Father said, choose this one, choose this one, choose this one, choose this one, choose this one. And so it was actually the Father that told the Son who to choose. And so he chose those 12 men. The ones you have given me, you told me who to choose. And so the Son did exactly that. And the Son declared the character of the Father to those disciples. They were yours. You gave them to me. In this next phrase, it gave me great joy. Here in the New King James Version. And they have kept your word. What a statement by Jesus to the Father about those disciples. Now, if you look through the Gospels, you will know those disciples were not always on point. Amen? They argued. They bickered who would be top dog in the kingdom. Even one of their boys' mamas got involved and saying, set my boys up, right, as, you know, number one, number two in your kingdom. They verbally fought with each other. Yet Jesus is saying here, they have kept my word. When I read that, it gave me great joy and great hope for me, because there are sometimes I'll look in the mirror and look at myself, and I'm not very perfect. Amen? And I would say things out of place. Amen? And I would do things I should not do. Yet Jesus can say, but Phil kept your word, Father. I said, oh, glory to God. What? You mean I'm still in? Glory to God. He said, they have kept your word. Through all the arguments, through all the disappointments, they have kept your word. Listen, I want you to know, you're not perfect, but Jesus says, but they kept my word. Glory to God. They kept my word. Now they have known that all things which you have given me are from you. For I have given to them the word which you have given me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I came forth from you, and they have believed that you sent me. These few verses here display the willingness of the Son to submit himself to the Father's rule and to understand that he only gave to the disciples what the Father gave to him. Jesus operated in this position that I'm only going to say what I hear the Father saying. I'm only going to do what I hear the Father doing. I see the Father doing. I'm only going to give whatever the Father gives me to give. He was in alignment. Though equal in the Godhead, he took the submissive role to be submitted to the will of the Father here on earth. That implies or states to us our role that we must take, even in different relationships we have at home or at work. Yes, your boss may not be smarter than you. You may have more education than him or her. But in the role that you have, you're supposed to follow the directions of your boss. Everyone said? Okay, that was about 30% of y'all. Real strength understands that even though I may be smarter or can do it better, the role that I am in is one of under you, so I'm going to take my position under you and follow the directions because that is the hierarchy. All right? In the home, at work, in the church, we must do it. There was a time when I first got to this church, and I was not anyone special, but I had pastored before, and I was teaching a Bible study on a Tuesday night, and the youth pastor came in and says, and we were teaching the sanctuary, and the youth pastor came in and says, I need the sanctuary, but I'm teaching the sanctuary. I understood my role as just a Bible teacher here. I gathered up my stuff and went to the back room. He's younger than me. I've been in this longer, but the role that he was in was one of authority. And so you humble yourself, right? And you operate under with an understanding of the authority that's in that particular organization. Are you with me? This is what Jesus displayed. Though he was equal with the Father, he humbled himself to the Father's will at every situation. If Jesus can do that or did that, that means we should do that as well. Amen? Verse 9. I pray for them. I do not pray for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. I pray for them, not the world. This is not a statement of dislike for the world, but it is a prayer of focus for the instrument or the tool that he would use to display his character to the end of time, which is the church. And so not that he did not like the world, this is a prayer of focus. So don't read this and interpret this that we cannot pray for the world. It's not that. What he was focused on was focusing on the instrument and the tool, and we are the instrument and the tool that he is using to display his glory and his goodness around the world. So he's praying for the disciples then. In a few more verses, you're going to see that we're praying for all of us. But I don't pray for the world, but I'm praying for them that you would keep them. Let me read verse 9 again. I pray for them. I do not pray for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. Let me skip down to verse 14. Verse 14 says, I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. When you operate from the basis of God's word, the world will hate you because you do not take on their mores, their customs, their viewpoints, their sinful celebrations of sinful behavior. When you operate from the basis of God's word, meaning this, every decision that I make is going to be based on what the word of God says. Not based on popular belief, all right? My decisions for myself, for my home, are based on the word of God. When you raise kids, your decisions on what they watch must be based on God's word, not on the social customs of that particular age. No matter if they say, well, Johnny's mama lets Johnny watch that. This ain't Johnny's house. Amen? We don't do that here. Turn that off. Now, I know kids are kids. They're going to sneak, but they ain't going to do it in front of me. Amen? When we fail to operate or make decisions based on the word of God, then our actions begin to blend into the world. I'm gonna say it again. When we fail to make decisions based on the word of God. Now, Jesus said, I've given them your word. Okay? So we have the word. If we fail to make our decisions based on the word of God, then all of our actions begin to blend in with the world. And we begin to look more and more like the world. We carry ourselves more and more like the world because we want to blend in. No, we can never blend in. We're not of the world. Amen? They begin to blend into the world, and there is no longer the display of distinction between the two kingdoms. I want you to understand this. When we fail to operate based on the word of God, we begin to blend into the world, and there is no longer this distinction between the two kingdoms. There is a kingdom of darkness and a kingdom of light. And if we don't stand apart, making our decisions based on the word of God, we begin to blend in, and the world cannot see a distinction or a difference between the kingdom of God and its world. And I want you to know, there is a huge difference. And we must display there is a distinction between holy and unholy, between right and wrong. There is a difference. Hallelujah. Verse 15 says, I do not pray that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil one. It was not and it is not the desire of Jesus to pull you from the earth right into heaven as soon as you get saved. Because there is a work he wants you to do right in that sinful community where he has you. Some of you are not going to like this. I'm going to say it anyway. Because of the liberality of the state in which we live in, California, many will say, I'm leaving California. I'm going to Idaho. But if the Lord tells you that's something different, then you need to go. But the Lord has not told you to go, then you need to stay. And so let me throw out this crazy example. What if every believer in California said, we're leaving California? Who would be left in California? The unsaved. Where does God want you? It's great having church with all of us, right? But there's a dying world out there who needs to know Jesus. Now, some of you may say, oh, I was thinking about leaving too, about moving out of California. And if God told you to do that, then do it. I'm not saying don't do it. What I'm saying is Jesus said, let me read it again. I do not pray that you should take them out of California. I'm not praying that you should take them out of the world. What I'm praying for is that you would keep them while they're in the world, that they would display a distinction between the two kingdoms. Because the world needs to know there's a different way of operating than how they've been operating. And it is the kingdom of God. We saw it today. There's a different way to live. These young men and young women shows us there's a different way to live. That's a distinction. One of the old saints, she made this prayer, and she prayed that God, she said, if God does not keep you, you cannot be kept. One of the old saints. You're talking about God's keeping power. If God does not keep you, you cannot be kept. And so what Jesus was saying, listen, I'm not praying that God would take you out of the world. I'm praying that he would keep you while you're there in the world. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Verse 17 says this. Everyone say sanctify. Sanctify. Growing up as a young kid, we went to what was called the sanctified church. Amen. No pants on women. Don't come in here with no pants on and makeup. I always said this, if the barn need painting, go ahead and paint the barn. All right, let me get back to this. Sanctify means this. Sanctify, to separate them by your truth. Sanctify them with your truth. Separate them by your truth. Dedicate them by your truth. Cleanse them by your truth. And then Jesus makes this statement that I love. He says, thy word is truth. The very utterance of God is truth. The very decrees of God are truth. The Old Testament prophetic word given by God, they are truth. Listen, the Old Testament is as valuable as the New Testament. He says, sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. Hallelujah. It is God's word that is truth. Charles Spurgeon said this. Said, the more truth you believe, the more sanctified you will be. I'm going to say it again. The more truth you believe, this right here, this is truth. The more I commit this to my life, the more sanctified you will be. Sanctification is not about clothing. It's not about makeup. It's not about running around the church. Huh? Sanctification is this. I'm going to live free and separated from the world and live my life unto God. I've been set apart for God's use. It's like this. My mom, and I'll use this analogy, my mom had plateware that we could describe as sanctified, because it was only used on Thanksgiving and Christmas. It stayed in the buffet. Y'all had a buffet? Stayed in the buffet. And we had our everyday dishes, and we had our sanctified dishes. Those we used at Thanksgiving and Christmas. And it would not be used unless it was those two occasions. What sanctification is, I'm only going to be used by God. I've been set apart for God's use. Sanctified. Not about clothing. Not about makeup. Not about you couldn't go to the movies or play sports. No. It's about being set apart for the use of God. Glory to God. I want to be sanctified. In fact, he is sanctifying me right now. Huh? Every time I get into this word, every time I apply this word to my life, I'm being sanctified. The Bible says that Jesus prayed that the Father would sanctify us. It is the Father sanctifying us through his word. That every time I apply this word to my life, every time I run to this word in the morning, in the evening, and apply it to my life, I'm being sanctified. I'm being set apart for the use of God. When I say no to the enemy, I'm being sanctified. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Verse 18. As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. Jesus is sending us into the world. All of us are not called to work for a Christian organization. All of us are not called to work for a Christian organization. When you say, well, I've been called to the ministry, that's great. It doesn't mean you're going to be preaching or pastoring. All of us have been called. We have been sent into the world, right? So I encourage you, go into politics. Oh, you that bad? We need some of y'all in politics. Amen. We need those sanctified men and women in politics. Glory to God. We need you in the educational field. As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into world. Into the what? Into the world. It isn't into the church. Into the world. I'm sending them into the world to show a distinction between the two kingdoms. Go into the entertainment industry. Oh, no, not that. Go there. Show a distinction between the two kingdoms. When they're drinking and acting a fool, you're not. And they're wondering why you're not doing that. And you can share with them about the things of God. Go. We have to show a distinction between the two kingdoms. And so he sent us. This word sent implies a mission. He's sending us on a mission to go into the world. See, that's what missionaries do. Team Challenge is a great mission organization. They go into the world, right? And by the power of God, draw people out of the world into the kingdom of God, and they show the distinction between living for God and for the devil. Glory to God. Oh, my goodness. Oh, man, man. Okay, let me go to verse 20. Verse 20 says this, and we're going to end here. Verse 20, I think. Verse 21 will end, and then we'll do communion. Okay. So I do not pray for these alone. So for those 11 that were there, not just for them, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. Talking about us. Prayer has an eternal effectiveness. Past the time of your death, your prayers are still effective. Understand this. Prayers have an eternal effectiveness. The angel of the Lord came and told Cornelius, Cornelius, your prayers and almsgiving have come up as a memorial before God. A memorial, a reminder. All right? Your prayers are this reminder. Mother prayed for my older brother, Butchie, for years. Mother passed away in 2005. Butchie did not get saved till 2007. Mother was gone, but her prayers were still effective. Hallelujah. Prayers have an eternal effectiveness. So even though you've prayed for loved ones and you may move on into glory, your prayers are still doing work. They're still before God as a memorial. It's like every time God walks through heaven, you say, oh, I got to pray for Bertha's son. I got to do something for Bertha's son. I got to do. They're memorial. Glory to God. And so he says, I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they all may be one. Okay. Jesus understood that while we live here in this flesh, the devil would always try to fragment the saints. So that's why he prayed this prayer. If there was no concern about us not being one, he would not have prayed for us to be one. There was always a concern that while we're here in the flesh, the devil would always try to fragment us. He has tried to use different ethnic backgrounds to fragment us. He has tried to use which day for our weekly public worship gatherings to fragment. Well, I worship the Lord on Saturday. Well, I do it on Sunday. He tried to use all those things to pull us apart. He's tried to use the political positions you may have to fragment us. Well, I'm red, or I'm blue, I'm liberal, I'm conservative, I'm Democrat, I'm Republican, I'm independent. He's tried to use all those things to separate us. And Jesus saw that and began to pray that that would not happen to Lighthouse. That we would not be fragmented by color. Amen? By whether I'm voting Democrat or Republican. Whether we're going to gather on a Saturday or a Sunday or a Friday. He has prayed for that. If you give into any of those tactics, you are actually resisting the very prayers of Jesus. Whenever you operate and you show a preference because you're a Democrat, you're a Republican, you're a black, you're a white, you're a Hispanic, you're an Asian, what you're doing is you're resisting the prayers of Jesus. And that is why the Bible says, I think in Ephesians, we have to endeavor, mean to labor, to work, to keep the unity of the peace, right? To keep that unity. We have to work at it. We have to make effort. That means we have to go out of our way to make sure we stay united. That means I've got to lay down my political position. Lay it down. I've got to lay down because I'm black. I can't hang out with whites. I got to lay that down. Amen? Because you work the Lord on Saturday and I do it on Sunday. I've got to lay that down so we can be one. Because this is what Jesus prayed for. How dare we take up those positions and cause a separation in the body of Christ? And this is what Christ has prayed for. Amen? Can we be one? Can we be one? Can we be one? Yes. For Jesus has prayed that we would be one. And watch this, what he said. What he said, that they all may be one as, or just like, similar scale, as you, Father, are in me and I in you. That they also be one in us. He said, just like we're in complete alliance, we have no beefs. The Father and Son had no beefs. Amen? He's saying, I'm praying that they, us, be like us. That they be at one. It can start today. If you look around you, it's not just black. It's not just white. Hispanic, Asian, here in one place. Amen? Different age groups. I would dare to say there's even some liberals in here. Right? We're all in here, this great tapestry, right? Making up one body. Amen? Glory to God. Listen, communion. Everyone have their cups? You do? You got it? Everyone? We're going to participate in communion. And then we're going to give a closing prayer and pray over the food that's out there. And I beg you to stay and grab a plate and sit down and get to know more about Teen Challenge. They're a wonderful group that we get to. We're privileged to be able to support you in what you guys do. And we're one in this. Yeah, we're one. We're one in this. All right. I'm going to do something I probably shouldn't do. I know either Michelle or my friend back there know a good communion song to sing. I'm putting them on the spot. I knew you were Sister George. You had to be able to sing. I wasn't sure you guys could do it. Listen, grab your elements. I want to read from the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 11. That this has a great meaning. John 17, he's headed towards the cross to pay this price for you and I. He calls it being glorified, to suffer. Paul said, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread." This bread, again, represents his body. "And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you, for you, for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Let's take of the bread. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the new covenant, the new testimony in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's drink of the cup. "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you guys are, right now we're proclaiming the Lord's death. But not just his death, but his resurrection. And watch this, and he's coming back again. He is coming back again. Let us stand to our feet, everyone. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Next to your daughter, put your arm around your daughter. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Understand this, the Lord loves you with this unfailing love. Unfailing. Though your Father loves you, he does not love you like your Heavenly Father loves you. And yes, and I want to apply this word to you. You've read it before, but I'm going to say it to you again from Jeremiah 29:11. I want you to know he has plans for you. And they're not plans to hurt you or to harm you. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Yes, yes. But to give you this great hope. Though at times you may feel that hope is gone, at times you may feel like, oh, the mistake I made was too costly, I want you to know he has plans for you. And in fact, before time began, he knew the mistakes or the bad decisions that you may make. Yet still, I got a plan. And in fact, the book of Ephesians says he works all things after the counsel of his will. He did not say just good things, but all things, meaning good and bad. God said, okay, you messed up. I can still work with that. I still got you. I want you to know God still got you. You receive that? Lift up both your hands. I want to pray for you. Lift up both your hands. Father, I thank you for this young lady, that you have plans for her. Not to hurt her, not to harm her. In fact, yes, Lord Jesus, you actually prayed for her back in 2,000 years ago. Your mind was on this young lady. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So I pray, God, that you would do a work in her like only you can do, oh God. That you would deliver her. You would set her free, oh God. That you would transform her life, oh God. That she would live out your will. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That there be nothing missing, nothing broken, nothing lacking in her life. I speak the word shalom, peace over you. Hallelujah. Fulfillment over you. What your desires are, that you would see those come to pass in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, I'm going to give you this opportunity. You can know Jesus today. If you're here and you don't know Jesus as your personal, you can know Jesus today. If you just simply say, Lord Jesus. In fact, let's all say it together. Can we do that? Say, Lord Jesus, thank you for praying for me. Thank you for dying on the cross for me. I receive you as my Lord and my Savior. I turn my back on the devil and all of his ways, and I'll live my life for you alone. Because of this, I'm saved. I'm saved. One more time, I'm saved. Come on, give God the praise in this house. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Listen, for those who are going to stay, I'm going to bless this food. Go and enjoy the meal we have planned for you. For those of you watching at home, I've got this video for Teen Challenge I want to show you. So, Father, thank you for the food that you have provided for us. We never go hungry because of you, because you always provide for us. I pray that you would bless it, the hand that prepared it as well. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. God bless you, and I'll see you next Sunday.
Yeah. our battle has been won. We have never